Okay, so I'm an economist. So I'm not a data scientist. I'm a scientist who needs data. Okay, that's why I'm here, because I'm greedy and I need more data. As economists, one of the most hardest questions we are facing is to think through why are some countries poor and some countries are rich. Okay, and we still don't really quite know. And you may say, well, that's abysmal as a performance. But may I remind you, there are only 195 countries in the world. So if you try to do data science to think about why some countries grow and some don't, we only have 195 observations. Okay, of course, we have multiple years, but still it's very, very small data. In the era of big data, that's very tiny. And on top of it, what we know about these countries is maybe something like, you know, GDP, which is like just one of the very, 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 very many ways you want to think about well-being and development. So when I say I need data, it's because there are many, many questions that we could answer much better, and we could think through this big question of why are some countries growing faster or some countries not growing at all, if we had more data enabling us to understand better how, what tiny areas of the world, even within a country, but you know, which region of a given country is doing better than some other. What do we know about these regions? Can we try to trace out the history of how resources were allocated and the type of, you know, government structure that they have in place and stuff like that? And this is where actually having this fine-grained information about, you know, what type of infrastructure do you have in this part of the country, what type of outcomes do people face, we actually know nothing about that. If you want to know the GDP per capita of a region in a country, it's actually pretty difficult unless you have already quite advanced that capacity. For most countries in the world, if you want to know how, you know, truly poor a given area is, it's going to be very hard. So that's why I'm here, is because recently we started thinking with colleagues in political science and in economics about ways to team up with, you know, folks like Stefano, who is going to be speaking after me, in computer science, who help us come up with new data. So making useful data from existing data streams. And so I'm going to just share one example of some work that we've started doing about a year ago with Stefano and some others to try to think in particular about ways to get a sense for where, who in the world has better access to basic amenities like, you know, water, electricity, sewage, okay? And so why would you, so we're gonna, you know, there are two goals. The first goal of this is kind of like with Stefano, and he's gonna talk about this a little bit as well, which is, can we use satellite imagery to identify basic measures of physical infrastructure and provision of public goods? So that's just the data science aspect. Is it actually possible? Okay. And then once this answer has been, this question has been answered, you know, Stefano is happy and he can move on to the next project, but I'm not happy yet. Okay. Because what I want to do is use these measures of physical infrastructure that have been predicted from this imagery as what we call dependent variables in economic analysis. I can now look at how resources are allocated, who gets what, and stuff like that. And why is it important to measure infrastructure access? That's only one of the examples of the thing we care about, but it's important because it helps us understand the true quality of life and how it's distributed across parts of the country, can help us help policymakers plan effectively and distribute resources, also keep leaders, you know, aware and accountable of what's going on, and help target better, okay? And the reason why it's hard to do right now is because there's a dearth of evidence, as I just mentioned. So if you look at just the number of asset surveys that have been done, in Sub-Saharan Africa in particular, over a period of 10 years, most countries have had like at most one asset survey that was done. By asset survey, it just tells you how much, you know, what assets people have. Typically, it also tells you whether they have access to water and electricity. And this is nationally representative, but it's still going to just tell you the information for maybe like 10,000 households in the country and not every single pixel on the map, okay? So we need this data. And, you know, in the past, people have tried to do, to use satellite imagery to do predictions for related stuff, like know where there's land that is being used or not, try to identify the quality of the roads that people have. And the third example is using nightlights as a proxy for development. So in economics, that has been like the frontier of using new data. Was like, oh, right, let's look at how highly lit an area is at night. It's going to tell us how developed it is. And it is, you know, informative. If I show you this picture, for example, can you tell me what this is? Exactly. So this is Korea. So this is South Korea. It's not an island. this is North Korea, and you can see Pyongyang here, okay? But so from this you can see, oh wow, we can actually learn a lot from just looking at the world from space, because you know, if someone had no idea what has been going on in Korea for the last 50 years, they would actually realize, huh, there must be something going on. The level of economic activity clearly cannot be the same. Okay? So you can learn a lot from just looking at this, except that this is the case that's so clear that we actually know about it. We don't need the night lights data. So what we want to do, and so you can now, you know, the key question is, can we actually exploit this to say, well, within South Korea, for example, is it the case that, you know, there is much more life here than here? Is it because, you know, people here are actually poorer than here? Okay, that may be a forest, so maybe that's not an interesting question. But in a country where you have actually no information whatsoever, if we can actually understand the distribution of economic activity within the country, we can now start thinking a bit more about why there may be some challenges to growth. Okay, so we want to do this, but not just with night lights, we want to go further. Why? Because within sub-Saharan Africa, actually most pixels are unlit at night. Okay, so if you just look at the map of Africa from sky, it looks like at night there's not much going on. You can see the capital cities and then not much else. So we want to go beyond that and say, well, even if there's no lights at night, can we say something about how what's going on and how well off the people are? So the first step is going to be to, you know, to train a model to like figure out to create some predictions as to this area. Can I accurately predict whether it has access to these infrastructure measures? And so for that you need training data, which is a big challenge because I just told you we don't know what's going on. We don't know who has what. And now I'm telling you, well, I need to know who is what to know whether my model is doing a good job. Okay. So we found one type of training data that we could use, which is this Afrobarometer survey that collects data from a bunch of African countries in different enumeration areas. So you can see on this map, all the dots are areas that have, you know, some measure of access to infrastructure. And what is showing here is whether they have access to pipe water, and the red is no, and the green is yes. And we are going to then try to see whether we can predict accurately what they have from satellite imagery, and then check whether how well it does, okay? And so that's what, you know, Stefano is the expert on this, so he's going to say a little bit more than me. I just wanted to say this is the type of imagery that can be used. We have Landsat 8 and Sentinel 1, and you just kind of like do a whole bunch of stuff that I don't actually know how it works because I'm not a data scientist. And then it spits out some predictions. And in this case, actually, after some, you know, fine-tuning, it seemed to be doing quite well in the sense that you can predict quite accurately who has what. I mean, one of the measures that we like to look at is this area another curve, and it's actually doing a pretty good job, and in fact, a better job than night lights. So, for example, knowing whether an area has electricity or not, you'd do a better job predicting that using the model that we trained than using night lights density. Okay, so that's the first step, and we've come a long way in that step. But now we want to do step two, which is to use these predictions now for the whole continent of Africa and then do something with it. And in particular, study the distribution of access to infrastructure, and that can help us, as I said before, thinking about targeting. That can also help us as you know, economists, right, to think through the determinants of infrastructure placement and then the extent to which, you know, governance issues like patronage or ethnic politics come in the way. And can we now make progress in understanding this big question of why some countries have a harder time growing by understanding whether it's because in part the way infrastructure is allocated, you know, hindering development in so many ways. So that's just one example of the thing that we would like to do. We think that it would be great to use other data streams, like you know, cell phone records, to be able to do some other stuff, like for example, understand migration patterns much better. We think it'd be great to also use that to understand, you know, political protests and repression. And there's all sorts of things that we think could be done. At the same time, each time we think about these things, we can also think of all the potential risks that come along with this type of data being used for the research that we have in mind. And so hopefully this is something we can discuss in the panel, which is the extent to which all this new data can be used for good, but also sometimes, you know, for bad if it falls in the wrong hand. And that kind of like makes us a bit cautious as academics. Thank you.